Well, good evening, and welcome to the fourth event in this year's Humanities Lecture Series. I'm Victor Bailey, director of the whole centre, which puts the series together. It's our great pleasure this evening to bring you Harvard professor Stephen Greenblatt, one of the most influential literary scholars in the North American Academy. Professor Greenblatt will take questions after his talk, if you would make your way to one of the two microphones in the aisles. Afterwards, in the Jayhawk Room, which is diagonal to this auditorium, there's a reception for our guest speaker, who will also sign copies of his books. Do please join us there. Tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock, as it says in your program, in the Hall Center, Professor Greenblatt will present Will in the World, a conversation, the will in question being, of course, Mr. Shakespeare. These morning events are really very enjoyable and very intimate occasions, so I do encourage you to attend. To introduce Stephen Greenblatt, there was only one person in the frame, or at least in my frame, and that was Professor Emeritus of English, David Bergeron. Importantly, for present purposes, David is a renowned scholar of Shakespeare and Shakespearean England. His books are numerous and compelling. English Civic Pageantry, 1558 to 1642, appeared in 1971, and again in a revised edition in 2003. 1985 saw the birth of Lusty Twins, Pageantry in the Shakespearean Theatre, and Shakespeare's Romances and the Royal Family. 6 years later, there appeared Royal Family, Royal Lovers, King James of England and Scotland. More recently, in 2006, he published Textual Patronage in English Drama. As if this were not enough, he has authored almost 100 articles, essays, and entries, a number worthy of a scientist's vita. The difference is that scientists publish papers with 32 other authors. David's are almost all single-authored. He's garnered fellowships and research grants from the American Council of Learned Societies, the Folger Shakespeare Library, and the Huntington Library. He's received the highest research achievement prize at KU, the Balfour Jeffrey Award, and he won a W.T. Kemper Fellowship for Teaching Excellence. All this achievement aside, I can also testify to the fact that there is no finer colleague on campus than David Bergeron. He has an attractive, self-deprecating humor and an eye and ear for the ironic in life and for puncturing humbug. Please welcome Professor David Bergeron.
I think I'll just go ahead and give my lecture now. Being brought out of retirement for this very pleasant duty makes me think I might be, in deference to my K-State friends, the Bill Snyder of the English department at KU. And so I began. It was a dark and stormy night. Why does that always produce laughter? It was a dark and stormy night, I'll do it again, that led to a bright, sunny day in Stratford-upon-Avon in August 1981. While standing on Stratford streets, I encountered a 30-something young man who approached me and introduced himself. It was Stephen Greenblatt, then professor of English at the University of California at Berkeley. We were attending an international Shakespeare conference. Stephen was there in part to bask in the glow of the acclaim being afforded to his magnificent, recently published, path-breaking book, Renaissance Self-Fashioning. I was there to bask in the glow of, well, the late summer English sunshine. From this moment some 30 years ago, Professor Greenblatt's professional life has swerved into richly deserved increasing respect, renown, and yes, fame. His fame can be measured in part by learning that a book about him has been published. And most important, perhaps, he has appeared as a Shakespeare expert on the Colbert Report. After 28 years of teaching at Berkeley, Greenblatt moved to Harvard in 1997, where today he holds the John Cogan University Professorship in the Humanities. He has published some 12 books, has served as president of the Modern Language Association of America, and has won numerous grants and fellowships. Along the way, Stephen Greenblatt, in effect, established an exciting field of literary criticism known generally as New Historicism, although he might prefer the term Poetics of Culture. This development set a beneficial fire under the operations of literary criticism. Greenblatt's biography of Shakespeare, Will in the World, about which he will speak tomorrow morning, was prize-winning and best-selling. And now his latest book, The Swerve, the subject of tonight's lecture, has won both a National Book Award and a Pulitzer Prize. And I understand why. This is a brilliant book that shows how an academic scholar steeped in the intricacies of a bygone era can bring to life a seemingly unimportant topic, namely the 15th century discovery of Lucretius' poem, now 2,000 years old. Greenblatt's lucid, imaginative, and powerful prose captures our imagination. I have learned much from this engaging book, including some very interesting minor tidbits. For example, I discovered on page 134 that Europe's 15th century universities, quote, consisted of scholars and masters, and humanists were usually paid much less than professors of law and medicine. Thank goodness that no longer exists. We've swerved. Maybe that's how the world became modern. Stephen writes of the Renaissance that coursing through all was, quote, a glorious affirmation of vitality. I can think of no better description of his success in this book. With great pleasure, I now swerve so that we can welcome our distinguished guest to University of Kansas, Stephen Greenblatt.
It's magnificent. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Victor Bailey and the Hall Center. Thank you, David Bergeron, for that wonderful and generous introduction in which you didn't puncture too much humbug. And so I'm grateful to you for that. And I'm very honored and delighted to be here and on campus and in this historic city and on such an incredibly beautiful day. I'm coming from Rome, and I discovered that the skies are as blue over Lawrence as they are over the Colosseum. I want to talk today about issues raised in my book, but I want to focus not on the story I tell, which is fun and exciting, so I probably should just retell it, but instead on how the work that was discovered made it through the net that was meant, in effect, to catch and stop something like this from happening. I'll begin with a quote from St. Augustine. What death is worse for the soul than the freedom to err? Among the master builders of Christian orthodoxy, of whom Augustine, of course, is the greatest master of all, there was little tolerance for toleration. Though they had themselves been ruthlessly persecuted, once in power, Christians moved as quickly as they could to suppress rival systems of belief and of worship. And in doing so, they confirmed the charges that had led to the persecutions in the first place. Christians could not, pagans argued, be treated in the way that state authorities in the Roman Republic and later the Empire had ordinarily treated newly encountered religions. That is, Christianity could not and would not be assimilated, its reigning divinity aligned by sophisticated pagan intellectuals to the existing panoply of the gods. Not only was Christianity monotheistic and hence unwilling to acknowledge the existence of other gods, but it was also Catholic in the sense of universal, and hence it was committed to urging everyone to abandon their time-honored religious practices. A succession of Christian emperors, beginning with Theodosius the Great in 391 of the Christian era, issued edicts forbidding public sacrifices and closing the major cultic sites. The state had embarked on a momentous process, which was the destruction of paganism. Is it not true that we're dead and living only in appearance? This is the pagan poet Palladius asking in the wake of the destruction of the Serapion, the great temple to Serapis in Alexandria. Is it not true that we're dead and living only in appearance, we Hellenes, fallen on disaster, likening life to a dream, since we remain alive while our way of life is dead and gone? From this point onward, Palladius intuited his world was sliding into the strange state of suspended animation, of living death, that is the fate of cultural relics. And it's this peculiar fate that will be the topic of my talk tonight. As I say, I'm living this year in Rome, which is the world's largest archaeological site, in some sense the world's largest graveyard. And it is a place in which the dead are in this strange state of suspended animation. To its monotheism and its universalism, Christianity conjoined a commitment to a single doctrinal coherence, an absolute coherence, that was alien both to the pagan and Jewish traditions. The ancient rabbis were always fighting with each other for dominance, and they frequently issued fierce charges at one another. But those early rabbinical texts, the texts like the Midrash Rabbah and other Talmudic texts, portions of which date from the time of Augustine, bear witness to an openness, a lack of resolution, or simply even of the possibility of resolution, that would have been unacceptable to the most ambitious Christian theologians. The spirit of the Talmud is obviously distinct from that of pagan religious speculation of the kind that you find in something like Cicero's dialogue on the nature of the gods. But texts like this, Jewish and pagan, were written in a spirit that the contemporary historian of science, Bruno Latour, calls compositionism. Compositionism. Now, Augustine, in the 4th century, set in motion the process that would lead away from what Latour is describing to the dream of doctrinal absolutism, the search which would never, of course, be completed for a theology that is not fragile, revisable, and diverse, not composite material, but unshakable, unchangeable, single, coherent. The motivation was not only a certain kind of philosophical ambition, but it was also a peculiar concern for the fate of the soul. That is to say, Christianity could not tolerate the circulation of false beliefs for the same reason that the state, as Thomas More put it centuries later, the state could not tolerate the sale of poisoned bread. You can't do that. You can't do that to people. And that's why, even though it perhaps seems unsympathetic to us, that's why a fundamental care for the health and safety of those in your charge must commit you to protect them from grievous harm. Thus, where we began with Augustine, what death is worse for the soul than the freedom to err? And that question was posed in the context of a debate with, as the title suggests, with a Christian rival Christian group called the Donatists. And it directs us to a crucial feature of Christian orthodoxy, which is that particularly intense persecutorial attention was paid not to the relics of vanquished beliefs, and not even to rival faiths, but to deviations, often very subtle, within the one true faith. The word heresy derives from the Greek term hieresis, which signifies choice, and it's precisely choice and the attendant idea that there might be multiple competing positions among which one might choose in the manner of the Midrash or of the competing Greek philosophical schools that theological absolutism decisively rejected. In its place was a single truth, and with it, a determination to weed out all false beliefs. I say again, of course, there wasn't a single truth. The Christians weren't fools. They understood they were competing truths, but the idea was to get to the point of a single truth and to stop the circulation of poisoned bread. For Augustine, the key biblical text was the parable of the wheat and the tares, which will be familiar to most of you, from Matthew 13. I confess to you that I had to look up to make sure I knew what tares meant. It's darnel or vetch, noxious weed. The kingdom of heaven is likened unto a man which sowed good seed in his field, but while men slept, his enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. But when the blade was sprung up and brought forth fruit, then appeared the tares also. So the servants of the householder came and said unto him, Sir, didst thou not sow good seed in thy field? From whence then hath it tares? He said unto them, An enemy hath done this. The servants said unto him, Wilt thou then that we go and gather them up? But he said, Nay, lest while ye gather up the tares, ye root up also the wheat with them. Now, this would seem like the least plausible support in the world for the vigorous persecution of heretics. To be sure, the tares didn't spring up naturally. They were planted by the enemy. And their very existence calls into question, as the servant's question suggests, calls into question the goodness of the seed that the master claims to have sowed, and also threatens to crowd out the life-sustaining crop. But the master explicitly tells his servants not to pull out the weeds for fear of destroying the wheat. The argument then would seem akin to Milton's argument in the Areopagitica, famous argument for the freedom of the press. But that's not at all Augustine's conclusion. In an influential interpretive move, a crucial move of the kind that intellectuals are extremely good at, that's what we're trained to do. In a key move, he argues against what seems to be the surface interpretation of Jesus' words. He argues that the parable, properly understood, has to license heresy hunting. The only reason, Augustine writes, that the master left the tares to grow until the harvest was the fear that uprooting them sooner would harm the grain. When this fear does not exist because it's evident which is the good seed, and when someone's crime is notorious and so execrable that it's indefensible, then it's right to use severe discipline against it. For the more perversity is corrected, the more carefully charity is safeguarded. The violent extirpation of false beliefs, the hunting down and extermination of the heretics, is in the service of charity. For the parable's cautionary words only applied to the period before the seed had fully ripened and grown. Since we now know clearly and decisively which is the wheat and which is the weed, that's, of course, the whole point of trying to get it right doctrinally, it's appropriate to act precisely as the closing words of Jesus' parable, rather, in this context, chillingly propose. Let both grow together, Jesus says, until the harvest. And in the time of harvest, I will say to the reapers, gather ye together first the tares, and bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn. The earlier admonition not to pull up the tares for fear of harming the wheat must not, as Augustine interprets these words, be taken as a guide to the appropriate treatment of heretics. For the parable distinguishes between two epochs, one of growth and the other of harvest. The former, as Augustine believes, referring to the past, and the latter to the present. We might want to argue with Augustine on this one, but we don't have the chance. Hence, this is the time, Augustine thinks, not of forbearance, but of gathering and burning. When the full power of the state was mobilized in support of this fateful conjunction of monotheism, universalism, and doctrinal absolutism, the consequence was the one that has been succinctly described by the historian Perez Zagorin. Of all the great world religions, past and present, Christianity has been by far the most intolerant. Such a summary judgment does not describe the present, and cannot possibly describe the day-to-day behavior of medieval and Renaissance Christians either. A mass of historical scholarship has documented the practical accommodations that men and women routinely made to confessional differences within their communities and even their families. These differences could on occasion erupt into violent conflict, and they did erupt into violent conflict from time to time, but for the most part, they simmered quietly in an uneasy convivencia. But the principle, at least, was clear. Heresy was classified as a capital crime, a serious crime, worse, as Aquinas put it, than forgery. And if you can execute forgers, you can certainly execute heretics. There are conflicting accounts of the process through which the world escaped from this nightmare, insofar as it has escaped from it. The Renaissance clearly played a significant role in this process through a set of things, through the reevaluation of pagan antiquity, the unsettling impact of New World discoveries, the very disturbing fact that a whole other massive number of people were encountered who didn't know anything about what appeared to be the truth, the slow growth of philosophical skepticism, the widespread popular revulsion in the wake of religious wars, and the determination of secular rulers to achieve a pragmatic solution to recurrent sources of public disorder and violence and growing feeling after a series of catastrophic experiences of enough already. But the issues were by no means quickly or decisively resolved. John Locke's celebrated letter concerning toleration, first published anonymously in Latin in the Netherlands in 1689, declared flatly that the care, therefore, of every man's soul belongs unto himself and is to be left to himself. But even here, at what must by any reckoning be the extreme outer end of the English Renaissance, 1689, very few of Locke's contemporaries agreed, or at least were willing publicly to declare that they agreed with this prescription, which was widely greeted as outrageous. Belief in one religion or another, Locke argued, could not be compelled, and dissent from one religion or another should not be punished. For all the life and power of true religion consists in the inward and full persuasion of the mind, and faith is not faith without believing. The church, therefore, Locke wrote, must be a free and voluntary society. I may grow rich by an art that I take not delight in. I may be cured of some disease by remedies that I have not faith in, but I cannot be saved by a religion that I distrust and by a worship that I abhor. As for the claims of orthodoxy, Locke wrote wonderfully, everyone is orthodox to himself. Now, it's important to grasp that even in late 17th century England, these views were widely and vehemently attacked as far beyond the pale of what was acceptable, and that Locke himself articulated a significant exception. "Those are not at all to be tolerated," he writes, "who deny the being of a God." Why, if religion consists in the inward and full persuasion of the mind, should toleration not extend to those whose minds are unpersuaded? Because, Locke noted, promises, covenants, and oaths, which are the bonds of human society, can have no hold upon an atheist. This argument, which was repeated by Pierre Bayle and various other contemporary advocates of religious toleration, there are many, not many, but there are quite a few figures in exactly this period, the late 17th century, who were beginning to articulate a position like Locke's, but they all come back to this position. This is a social argument. That is to say, it doesn't focus on the soul's eternal life, but it focuses on the here and now. Though the state cannot forcibly compel specific forms of belief on individuals, the community has a legitimate interest in protecting itself. And that protection is particularly necessary against those who would threaten the very foundation of social intercourse itself. The taking away of God, though but even in thought, dissolves all. Though but even in thought, well, ipsa opinione sublato, only by in opinion. Here at the very end of the English Renaissance, we find in the work of one of its most daring and enlightened figures a clear limit to what can be tolerated. It's a limit that strikingly echoes a position articulated more than 150 years earlier, at the very beginning of the English Renaissance, by another daring and enlightened figure, Thomas More. Eutropius, the founder of the Commonwealth that bears his name, in the famous work Utopia, had ruled, astonishingly from the perspective of More's Europe, that it should be lawful for every man to follow the religion of his choice, that each might strive to bring others over to his own, provided that he quietly and modestly supported his own by reasons, nor bitterly demolished all others if his persuasions were not successful, nor used any violence, and refrained from abuse. You have to know something, a little something, about the 16th century, and for that matter, the centuries before, to know how utopian this proposition is, that everyone, it would be lawful to follow the religion of your choice. But one position is emphatically not merely discouraged, but prohibited. More writes that Eutropius, the founder of this state, conscientiously and strictly gave injunction that no one should fall so far below the dignity of human nature as to believe that souls likewise perish with the body, or that the world is the mere sport of chance and not governed by any divine providence. Uneasy, perhaps, about specifying particular doctrines in a work that's attempting to challenge all doctrinal compulsion, John Locke, 150 years later, leaves the minimal belief altogether vague. All he says is, qui numen esset negant nulla modo tolerandi sunt. Whoever denies, negates the numen, whoever denies God can't be tolerated. He doesn't explain why negating the numen would dissolve the social fabric. At least More's utopians are more straightforward and more coherent about what they require and why. To be counted as citizens in this most tolerant of imaginary Renaissance states, a state so wildly embracing in its tolerance that no one in the real world could have imitated it, all utopians must profess a belief in post-mortem rewards and punishments in a universe governed by divine providence. Anyone who fails this belief test will be treated as subhuman and will therefore be enslaved or killed. Why? Because More has an answer. Who can doubt that he'll strive either to evade by craft the public laws of his country or to break them by violence in order to serve his private desires, when he has nothing to fear but laws and no hope beyond the body? So that question conjures up the specter that haunts even the most radical Renaissance defenses of toleration. We've reached the limit case, the point at which the earliest moment of the English Renaissance and the latest are conjoined in a mystic marriage of the implacable Catholic saint and the Protestant philosopher of the liberal Enlightenment, both of whom basically took the same position. And I probably don't have to remind you, and I'm about to shift ground, that we, certainly anyone of my generation, is aware of, well, I shouldn't say just of my generation, all of us are aware of comparable moments at which what looked like the fundamental collective understandings of how the culture works, what its basic rules are suddenly suspended in the face of something that seems like a threat that you cannot tolerate, and in the face of which you're inclined to suspend every one of the things that you think makes otherwise your collective social fabric coherent and tolerable. Okay, that's part one. Here's part two. The loss of almost the entire corpus of ancient materialist philosophy, the school of Democritus, Leucippus, and Epicurus, was not entirely accidental. Paganism, Judaism, and Christianity found much to admire in Plato and Aristotle, and hence they had a significant motive for preserving much of their work. Materialism, atomism, invited no comparable accommodation. When the strange figure called Julian the Apostate in the early 4th century of the Christian era, he's the emperor who attempted to revive paganism against the mounting onslaught of Christianity. When Julian drew up a list of works that it was important for pagan priests to read, there was a very strange moment in which the pagan emperor said, look, we want to revive paganism, and so I'll make a reading list for people in my empire to read the pagan classics, which you haven't been reading. And he notes some titles in that list that he explicitly wished to exclude. Let us not, he wrote, admit any discourses by Epicureans. Materialists, atomic materialists. And Jews, likewise, termed anyone who departed from rabbinical tradition as Hebrew word still for a non-believer, an atheist, is apikoiros, an Epicurean. And the church father Lactantius put the condemnation still more severely. Epicurus utterly destroys religion, Lactantius wrote. All of the works of Democritus and Leucippus have vanished, and apart from three letters quoted by an ancient historian of philosophy, along with a list of 40 maxims, virtually all of Epicurus, and there were hundreds of works, are lost. It's all the more surprising, then, that Lucretius's long poem, Epicurean poem, De Rerum Natura, from which we derive much of what we know about ancient materialism, that poem survived. That it did survive depended entirely on the vagaries of the monastic scriptorium, the place where these texts were copied. Two moments were crucial. There was the moment in which a monk requested permission or was assigned to copy the 7,400 lines of Lucretius's poem that would otherwise have perished along with much else. And there was the moment in 1417 in which this man, the papal bureaucrat and humanist book hunter Poggio Bracciolini, found the manuscript, had a copy made, and sent the copy to his friend Niccolo Niccoli. The central proposition of De Rerum Natura, T. Lucreticare De Rerum Natura, the book one, the central proposition of the poem, that the universe consists of atoms and the void, was hardly the dominant view of Poggio's world in the early 15th century. But it would not have come as a complete surprise. Intellectuals throughout the Middle Ages knew that such a theory existed, and they understood something of its significance in the debates of ancient physics. And it wasn't in that sense a complete surprise. After all, the world has to be made of something. And one possibility is that it's made of very tiny things, so small that they're invisible. But no one was prepared for the full implications of the interlocking argument that Lucretius carefully and eloquently lays out. For Lucretius argued not only that the world was made up out of an infinite number of indestructible tiny particles. He didn't call them atoms. He called them first beginnings, or the bodies of matter, the seeds of things, semina rerum, but also that nothing else existed, no other forms of being, and thus no immaterial demons, no angels, no ghosts, and no bodiless immortal souls. What followed was a succession of unacceptable propositions of the kind that gave Thomas More and John Locke, along with almost all of their Renaissance contemporaries, very bad dreams. And I will just quickly rehearse a few of the propositions that would have been particularly obnoxious. The universe has no creator or designer. The particles themselves, I'll just flash on the screen a few quotations from the poem that I won't go through them with you now. The particles themselves have not been made, and they cannot be destroyed. The problem was not only the claim that the matter of the universe was uncreated and immortal, but also, because after all, that's also something that Aristotle argued, and the Middle Ages had ways of dealing with that, but also that nature functions without any control or design. No control or design, ipsa sua per se sponte omnia disagere experts, without the help of the gods. What were the gods doing then? Well, this is a subject for a different talk, but Epicurus and Lucretius, who claimed at least that they believed in the gods, thought the gods were basically happy doing something else, not worrying about making anything in the world. Nature ceaselessly and randomly experiments. Holy Scripture was understood to mean that all species on the earth were created by God in the first days, over the first 6 days. There are people who still, after all, think this is the case. Mutations were observed, of course, but they were not part of an ongoing, evolving life process, Christians thought. And a strong bias toward the idea of design, a bias that most of us in our everyday life simply share for the obvious reason, since it makes sense, made it difficult even to grasp Lucretius's claim that that which was born creates, it creates the use. That which is born creates the use. That a very weird idea that if you've taken the evolutionary biology course, you have a handle on, but it's extremely hard otherwise to get your head around. Lucretius argued that the eyes and the tongue were not purpose-built for seeing or speaking. They were used after they mutated into existence, as it were. That notion seemed completely bizarre and incomprehensible to almost everyone until Darwin, and even now seems for most ordinary people almost impossible to fully grasp. What else? The world was not created for or about humans. There was, Lucretius thought, no original paradisal state designed to make humans feel at home. As a species, we make our way through an environment that's often hostile, and we're incredibly vulnerable. Consider, Lucretius wrote in a celebrated passage, how a baby, like a shipwrecked sailor flung ashore by fierce waves, lies on the ground naked, speechless, and utterly helpless as soon as nature has cast it forth with pangs of labor from its mother's womb unto the shores of light. Early humans, Lucretius thought, were not these magnificent, perfectly formed man and woman who suddenly got up and started speaking to each other, but they were extremely primitive and only slowly developed the skills that have enabled them to construct civilizations. The fate of the entire species, let alone that of any individual, is not, sorry to say, the pole around which everything revolves. Indeed, there's no reason to believe, Lucretius thought, that our species would last forever. It wasn't there at the beginning. There were other creatures before us. There would be other creatures after us. It was just part of an ongoing process of mutation. Humans are not unique. At first, this sounds perfectly acceptable, even welcome, even to a medieval Christian. But what this means is that we do not occupy a special privileged place in the order of creation. We're entirely part of the natural world, made of the same stuff that everything else is made of. And our lives can, in effect, be analyzed in the same terms that would be used to analyze all other creatures that forage for food and experience the drive to reproduce their kind. The soul dies. The human soul, Lucretius thought, is made of the same material as the human body. There is no afterlife, no posthumous punishments or rewards. Life on this earth is all that human beings have. When our bodies die, our souls die as well, and they cannot be reconstituted. All organized religions are superstitious delusions. The idea here in Lucretius is that humans project their desires and their fears onto imaginary creatures. They get frightened. The ancients in general thought that lightning and thunder terrified people and that most religion originated in the experience of hearing that terrible sound. And then they get trapped into false beliefs. There are entirely natural explanations for such phenomena as thunder and earthquakes. Lucretius spelled them out. But terrified humans instinctively respond with religious fear and start praying. Praying, he thought, is futile. And the horrors that are imagined in the afterlife are actually simply representations of what religions themselves produce in this life. And therefore, religions are invariably cruel, he thought. They always promise hope and love, but their deep underlying structure is based on anxiety and on retribution. Believers are conditioned to worry about impiety, but it's belief itself that should worry them. The quintessential emblem of religion and the clearest manifestation of the perversity that lies at its core, Lucretius thought, was the idea of the sacrifice of a child by its parent. Lucretius thought that all religions finally come back to that story. He's writing in about 50 before the Christian era, and he's thinking of the story of Agamemnon and Iphigenia, probably, in his own culture. Almost all religious faiths incorporate a myth of such sacrifice, and some, he says, have actually made it real. Oh, unhappy race of mankind, to ascribe such doings to the gods. The highest goal of life, Lucretius thought, is the enhancement of pleasure and the reduction of pain. Life should be organized to serve the pursuit of happiness. There's no higher ethical purpose than the facilitating of this pursuit for oneself and one's fellow creatures. All the other claims, the service of the state, the glorification of the gods or the ruler, the arduous pursuit of virtue through self-sacrifice, are secondary, misguided, or fraudulent. The militarism and the taste for violent sports that characterized Roman culture seemed to Lucretius in the deepest sense perverse and unnatural. He thought that man's natural needs were simple. A failure to recognize the boundaries of these needs leads human beings to a vain and fruitless struggle for more and more and more. Lucretius was horrified by the urge that people have to keep acquiring more and more and more, never being willing to stop this weird, tremendous desire, which he thought was part of the catastrophe of the human condition. Now, all of these propositions would have seemed utterly scandalous to the early 15th century. I probably don't have to tell you that no candidate for office in the United States could run on this platform either now. But certainly in the early 15th century, this was a world that was the heir to a rich centuries-old culture that worshipped an omnipotent, omniscient creator God, that celebrated spiritual transcendence and that constantly reminded itself of the atoning value of pain, suffering, and renunciation. Many of the greatest works of art in the Western tradition are from this period, from the 15th, 14th, 15th, 16th century, and are the expressions of that, of the richness and beauty of that culture that found this set of propositions absolutely horrific and unacceptable. And the fact that Lucretius's poem and the whole Epicurean discourse in which it participated had virtually completely dropped from view for centuries made its sudden return in 1417 all the more shocking. Because important works by Plato and Aristotle and Cicero had been in circulation, and there had been a very long process in which people could accommodate themselves to the idea. After all, Plato and Aristotle particularly, but were in effect Christianized in a very deep way in the course of the Middle Ages through a slow process of reading and commentary and appropriation. There was no such tradition for Epicureanism, no such tradition for Lucretius. After 1,000 years of virtual silence, then this return was uncanny. He spoke with supreme eloquence, but much of what he said seemed to all but a very few of Poggio's contemporaries impious, unbelievable, or simply incomprehensible. As a young man, Marsilio Ficino, who was the most brilliant philosophical mind of his age, began a commentary on De Rerum Natura, and then, seeing where it was taking him, he burned it and spent the rest of his life working on Plato, which is a more plausible enterprise. The return of De Rerum Natura, then, was the Renaissance at its most radical. Not a decorous, sedate recovery of classical harmony, the thing that we're most familiar with, the way in which most of our banks and office buildings look, but a weird, unnerving challenge to everything that right-thinking people believed to be true and good. The simple existence of unacceptable or even outrageous ideas from the defunct pagan past was bad enough, but it wasn't in itself an insuperable problem. It wasn't an insuperable problem because, in effect, however profoundly, as I said, it's important to understand how profoundly committed to doctrinal coherence and therefore how profoundly intolerant late medieval and Renaissance Christianity was, it wasn't the Taliban. It didn't decide to engage in an attempt to destroy every sign of non-belief wherever it would find. It just didn't want anyone around living to believe in these views. The problem was that Lucretius's ideas were articulated in an incredibly seductive form. The question, as Ficino seems to have understood, was one of proximity. How wise was it to get close to this poem? How safe was it to handle its most disturbing claims? For the better part of 2 centuries, the reception of Lucretius was a fugitive one, mingling anxiety, aversion, concealment, and fascination. And it's those 200 years that I want, in the time that remains, to talk about. How is it possible? What happens? Because it's something that must be going on right now, though we can't be fully conscious of it, because if we were conscious of it, I wouldn't be describing what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the things that you can't even fully see, or that look so weird that you can't make them out, or so horrible that you respond with nausea when you get intimations of them, but are moving, as it were, under the radar through your world, that you're not stopping. It wasn't until the late 16th century, almost 200 years after Poggio's discovery of the manuscript, that Giordano Bruno ventured to propose as his own belief the infinite universe, the ceaseless recombination of matter, the absence of providential design, and other distinctly Lucretian ideas. For his efforts, Bruno was imprisoned, interrogated, tortured, and then finally led to the stake in the Campo di Fiori in Rome. Now, the roughly 200-year time lag between the discovery of the text and Bruno's fatal public advocacy of its central principles marks a significant conceptual gap, even in the same object, between Renaissance and early modern. People in my field are very ambiguous about whether to call this period the Renaissance, the rebirth, or the early modern, the beginning of modernity. And it's because of this very ambiguous period, this strange zone. For many decades after Poggio's discovery, no prudent person stepped forward and said, I think the world is only atoms and void. That in body and soul, we're only fantastically complex structures of atoms linked for a time and destined one day to come apart. No respectable citizen openly said, look, I think the soul dies with the body. There's no judgment after death. The universe wasn't created for us by a divine power, and the whole notion of the afterlife is a superstitious fantasy. No one who wished to live in peace stood up in public and said, the preachers who tell us to cower in fear and in trembling are lying to us. God has no interest in our actions, and though nature is beautiful and intricate, it's not the product of an overarching intelligent design. What should matter to us is the pursuit of pleasure, for pleasure must be the highest goal of existence. These propositions were, for the entirety of the Renaissance, literally intolerable. But the poem survived and was allowed to circulate. So how then was the intolerable tolerated? And what I want to propose in what remains of this lecture is three answers. The first has to do with readily strategies of avoidance. This happens to be Ben Jonson's copy of Lucretius in the Harvard Library. It's much smaller than it is on the screen. The keeping of commonplace books trained readers to select individual passages, a sentence or two or an isolated paragraph that could be inscribed and committed to memory. And so too, the widespread practice of marginal annotation, jotted comments, underlinings, asterisks, and little drawings of pointed figures tended to focus on specific points of interest rather than on larger meanings. And one thing that people in my trade do, and there are many of you here tonight, is to spend time looking at these weird little jottings in the margins of old books. Now we try not to allow people to do it, and soon it won't matter anyway because it's all digitized. But there are lots of these marks. In a fine study of Lucretius's first Renaissance readers, Ada Palmer has carefully analyzed the annotations in 54 surviving manuscripts of De Rerum Natura from the period after 1417, as well as the first four printed editions. And she found that early Renaissance readers had a pronounced tendency to avoid remarks of any kind on Epicurean atomism or the denial of providence or the critique of religion. It's a slightly weird game, scholarly game, but you notice where the marks are, but you also pay a lot of attention to where the marks conspicuously are not. And no one wrote marks next to any of the passages of the kind that I've just rehearsed for you. Instead, the comments made philological connections. They commented assiduously on Greek and Latin vocabulary. They speculated on scansion, and they took notes on natural history and on Roman culture. Perhaps the readers were prudently careful not to call attention to the passages in the poem that would have aroused the ire of the defenders of Christian orthodoxy, because these marginal notes were the equivalent of, let's say, Gmail. They could be looked at by other people. Or perhaps their eyes slipped over those passages in conscious or unconscious aversion to something that they considered disagreeable or merely foolish. The second answer, closely related to the first, has to do with a practice that's rarely credited properly for its role in the history of toleration, and that is scholarship. This is an early scholarly edition, very early scholarly edition from the late 15th century of Lucretius. And what you're looking at, I don't have a pointer, The little stuff at the top, those are the lines of the poem, Lucretius' poem. All the rest is commentary. And it goes that way through the whole thing. Scholars set to work on what they took to be a poem whose core vision of the world was in effect dead as the oracles who had fallen silent, as dead as the cult of the pagan gods routed by the coming of Christ. They did not wish to call that world back to life. Applied to humanist scholars, the term Renaissance, as used by Vasari to describe the achievements of artists, that term is misleading. They didn't mean this to come back to life, to be reborn, but they intended to prolong the existence of the dead work, to make its corpse accessible to those who now contemplated it from the shores of revealed truth. They gave it, in effect, a kind of artificial homeostasis after death through an elaborate support system of learned references designed to make its language and its imagery comprehensible. The support system completely surrounded the body, at once containing it and sustaining it. With their assistance, De Rerum Natura was on its way to becoming a school text, a staple in the curriculum. Only in December 1516, almost a full century after Poggio's discovery, did the Florentine Synod, which was an influential group of high-ranking clerics, conclude that this homeostasis, this homeostatic survival, keeping the corpse alive in that enormous apparatus, was itself dangerous. They prohibited the reading of Lucretius in schools. Its exquisite Latin may have tempted school teachers to assign it to their students, but it should be banned, the cleric said, as, quote, a lascivious and wicked work in which every effort is used to demonstrate the mortality of the soul, end quote. Violators of the edict were threatened with eternal damnation and a fine of 10 ducats. It actually, the prohibition put several publishers out of business because they had overstocked on that enormous book. The prohibition might have restricted circulation and then effectively halted the printing of Lucretius in Italy, but it was too late to close the door. A scholarly edition had already appeared in Bologna, another in Paris, another from the great press of Aldus Manutius in Venice, and another set of editions in Florence. If complete suppression proved impossible, there was at least some consolation for the enemies of Lucretius in the fact that most printed editions carried disclaimers. One of the most interesting of these points us in a different direction from the scholarly prolongation, what I'm calling homeostasis here, and toward a third answer. There's an amazing edition done in France in 1563 by someone named Denis Lambin. And he writes that it's true Lucretius denies the immortality of the soul, rejects divine providence, and claims that pleasure is the highest good. Those are bad things to say. But, Lambin wrote, quote, even though the poem itself is alien to our religion because of its beliefs, it is no less a poem, end quote. Once the distinction has been drawn between the work's beliefs and its artistic merit, the full force of that merit can be safely acknowledged. He goes on, merely a poem? Rather, it's an elegant poem, a magnificent poem, a poem highlighted, recognized, and praised by all wise men. Well, what about the content of the poem? Those, quote, insane and frenzied ideas. Secure in their faith, good Christians do not have to worry. Quote, neither is it difficult for us to refute them, nor indeed is it necessary, certainly when they're most easily disproved by the voice of truth itself or by everyone remaining silent about them, end quote. Disavowal shades into a reassurance subtly conjoined with a warning. Get that it's a great poem. Sing the praises of the poem, but be silent about what the poem is saying. At least one of the early readers of Lambin's edition, the great essayist Montaigne, was unable or unwilling to remain silent about its ideas. This is Montaigne's copy of Lambin's Lucretius. It's covered with Montaigne's comments and notes. There are almost 100 quotations from Lucretius in Montaigne's essays, and more importantly, Montaigne grapples throughout his work with many of the issues that lie at the center of De Rerum Natura. But all of this is framed by repeated assurances of Montaigne's genial willingness to submit to Christian orthodoxy, and by a skeptical avoidance of any positive certainties of the kind that characterized Lucretius's vision. In the margins of his own copy of Lucretius, Montaigne carefully marked all of those places in the poem which were, as he put it, contre religion. And his most public appreciation of Lucretius's achievement is precisely, as Lambin had advised, explicitly aesthetic. In a remarkable essay on sex called On Some Verses of Virgil, Montaigne quotes Lucretius's sublimely erotic description of Venus and Mars. Lucretius wrote the most, according to the poet Yeats, the greatest description of sexual intercourse ever written. Montaigne quotes Lucretius's description of Venus and Mars, and then he writes the following: "When I ruminate that reikit, pascit, inhians, molly, fovet, medullus, labefacta, pendet, pecurit, and that noble circumfusa, mother of the pretty infusus, I despise those petty conceits and verbal tricks that have sprung up since." The aesthetic appreciation of Lucretius depended on the possession of very good Latin, and hence the poem's circulation was limited to a relatively small elite group who could understand and take pleasure with Montaigne in whatever it is he's getting excited about in the pretty infusus. Everyone grasped that any attempt to make it more broadly accessible to the literate public world would arouse the deepest suspicion and hostility from the authorities. More than 200 years apparently passed after Poggio's discovery in 1417, before an attempt was actually made, at least as far as we know. No one has discovered any attempt to translate the poem for 200 years after it was found. But by the 17th century, the pressure of new science, growing intellectual speculation, and the lure of this poem itself had become too great to contain. The brilliant French astronomer, philosopher, and priest, Pierre Gassendi, devoted himself in the early 17th century to an ambitious attempt to reconcile Epicureanism and Christianity, and one of his most remarkable students, the playwright Molière, undertook to produce a verse translation, which unfortunately doesn't survive. Lucretius had already appeared in French in a prose translation, and not long afterwards an Italian translation by the mathematician Alessandro Marchetti began to circulate in manuscript, to the dismay of the Roman Catholic Church, which kept it from appearing in print for decades and decades. In England, the wealthy diarist John Evelyn began to circulate his work and eventually translated the first book of Lucretius's poem. A complete version in heroic couplets was published in 1682 by the young Oxford-educated scholar Thomas Creech. So the first published English translation, printed English translation, of a work discovered in 1417 was in 1682. In England. Creech's Lucretius was greeted as an astounding achievement when it appeared in print, but an English translation of almost the entire poem, also in couplets, was already in very limited circulation and from a very surprising source, this one. The translation, which wasn't printed until the 20th century, was by a Puritan lady, Lucy Hutchinson, the wife of Colonel John Hutchinson, who was a parliamentarian and regicide. What's most striking about this remarkable accomplishment is that by the time the learned translator presented the text on June 11, 1675, she wrote that she had come to detest its central principles, or so she claimed, and to hope that they'd vanish from the face of the earth. Why, when she earnestly hopes that so much wickedness would disappear, did she painstakingly prepare a verse translation then, pay a professional scribe to write out the first five books and carefully copy out book six in her own hand? Her answer is a very revealing one. She hadn't initially realized, she confessed, how dangerous Lucretius was. She undertook the translation out of youthful curiosity, to understand things I had heard so much discourse of at second hand. We have, through this odd remark, a glimpse of those quiet, intense conversations conducted not in the lecture hall and not from the pulpit, but away from the prying ears of the authorities, in which Lucretius's ideas evidently were weighed and debated. This gifted, learned, remarkable woman wanted to know what the men were talking about in the other room. And she set out to find out by translating the poem for herself. But why, once she had satisfied her curiosity, did Hutchinson not suppress what she'd found? "I turned it into English," she writes, "in a room where my children practiced the several qualities they were taught with their tutors, and I numbered the syllables of my translation by the threads of the canvas I wrought in," she was doing needlework, "and set them down with a pen and ink that stood by me." Hutchinson was keenly aware, as this remark suggests, that Lucretius was a poet, and she in turn was responding as a poet, following what she called her aspiring muse. She was not embarrassed to do so as a woman. On the contrary, she calls attention here to the domestic scene in which she was writing. And with a backward glance at John Evelyn, she observed that a masculine wit presented to the public only a single book of a difficult poem and thought it worth printing his head in a laurel crown. The laurel crown, that is to say, the aesthetic dimension of the ancient work and the aesthetic challenge it posed to its heirs, is a key element in the survival and transmission of what was perceived by Hutchinson and virtually everyone else in her world as intolerable. The thought police were only rarely called in to investigate works of art for their heretical implications. But it was not only a matter of formal censorship. Artists, most of whom thought of themselves as good Christians, were able to express in their work what they would not have found palatable as philosophical or ethical propositions. Lucretius himself anticipated precisely this effect. His philosophical master and guide, Epicurus, was suspicious of eloquence and thought that the truth should be uttered in plain, unadorned prose. Lucretius, creating an astonishing work of art, justified his poetic power by comparing his verses to honey smeared around the lip of a cup that contains medicine that a sick child might otherwise refuse to drink. It's easy to read this metaphor as a reduction of art to something merely palliative, a trick to sweeten something that otherwise tastes nasty. But the history that I've traced in this hour, the fact that almost all of Epicurus has vanished while Lucretius's poem has survived, suggests that the metaphor has a deeper meaning than might at first appear, a meaning linked to Lucretius's interest in why certain forms of life disappear while others endure and recreate themselves. That was a central interest of Lucretius. How is it that some things make it organically and some things fail? And Lucretius clearly thought that art was linked to the possibility of survival. This survival points to a further power in Lucretius's art. The realization that the universe consists of atoms and void and nothing else, that the world was not made for us by a providential creator, that we're not the central figures in the universe, that our emotional lives are no more distinct than our physical lives from those of other creatures, we're not that different from pigs and cows and lions, that our souls are as material and as mortal as our bodies. The realization of the nature of things, Lucretius thought, should not bring with it a sense of cold emptiness, as if the universe had been robbed of its magic. That was a central charge, by the way, against Epicurus. In a wonderful passage, Cicero, who doesn't like Epicureanism, rehearses some of these ideas and says the Epicureans represent this idea that the soul dies with the body and the rest of it as very good news. And Cicero says, this is good news? But Lucretius has to make it feel like it is not simply bitter and cold. The origin of philosophy, it was often said in the ancient world, was wonder. Surprise and bafflement led to a desire to know, and knowledge in turn laid the wonder to rest. But in Lucretius's account, the process is something like the reverse. It's knowing the way things are, that should awaken the deepest wonder. The poetic greatness of Lucretius's work is not in that sense incidental to its visionary power. Why should the tellers of fables, he thought, possess a monopoly on the means that humans have invented to express the pleasure and beauty of the world? Without those means, the world we inhabit runs the risk of seeming inhospitable. And for their comfort, people will prefer to embrace fantasies, even if those fantasies are destructive. With the aid of poetry, however, the actual nature of things, an infinite number of indestructible particles swerving into one another, linking together, coming to life, coming apart, reproducing, dying, recreating themselves, forming an astonishing, constantly changing universe, can be depicted in its true splendor. Human beings, Lucretius thought, must not drink in the poisonous belief that they're only part of this world temporarily and that they're heading somewhere else. That belief will only spawn in them a destructive relation to their environment and to the only lives that they have. These lives, like all other existing forms in the universe, are contingent and vulnerable. All things, including the Earth itself, will eventually disintegrate and return to the constituent atoms from which they were composed, and out of which other things will form themselves in the perpetual dance of matter. But while we're alive, we should be filled with the deepest pleasure, for we're a small part of the vast process of world-making that Lucretius celebrated as essentially erotic. Hence it is that as a poet, a maker of metaphors, Lucretius could do something very strange, something that appears to violate his conviction that the gods are deaf to human petitions. On the Nature of Things opens with a prayer. This poem by someone who says that prayers are foolish, a prayer to Venus. We do not know how the German monks who copied these verses and kept them from destruction responded to that prayer, and we don't know what Poggio Bracciolini, who must at least have glanced at them when he salvaged the poem from oblivion, what he thought that they meant. Certainly almost every one of the poem's key principles, as I've said, was an abomination to right-thinking Christians. But the poetry was compellingly, seductively beautiful, and we can see with hallucinatory vividness what at least one great English poet, a poet of strong, of impeccable Protestant credentials, made of them. Great Venus, queen of beauty and of grace, the joy of gods and men, that under sky dost fairest shine and most adorn thy place, that with thy smiling look dost pacify the raging sea and makes the storms to fly. Thee, goddess, thee the winds, the clouds do fear, and when thou spreadst thy mantle forth on high, the waters play and pleasant lands appear, and heavens laugh, and all the world shows joyous cheer. This is not an expression of toleration in any sense that Thomas More or Locke would have understood. As we've seen, such toleration, only feebly present as a concept in this period, would not in any case have been extended by Edmund Spencer or anyone else to the key ideas articulated in De Rerum Natura. What occurred instead of toleration in the Renaissance was aesthetic embrace. This appropriation was made possible by what I've called the prolongation of the ancient world, that homeostatic prolongation by humanist scholarship. But in the scholarly editions, the work was cadaverous and silent. It came truly alive only in moments such as the one that we've just glimpsed in The Faerie Queen, a brilliant stitching of the alien thing into a new body, a triumphant saving. And perhaps, therefore, to that heart-lung machine, the iron lung that I showed you, I should adduce a further medical marvel, though I don't have a good picture of it, but something that's in the news, that weird thing that doctors can now do where they can take part of another body, a dead body, or a body that didn't even belong to a human, and stitch it into you and make it live in you. That is to say, we could call this act of aesthetic appropriation or embrace, such as we've just seen in Spencer, what medicine is called a xenograft. a piece of an ancient work of art, an ancient poem, a pagan poem, that had been kept alive, was cut out and incorporated into a living work of art. The great Renaissance creators, the Spenser of the Hymn to Venus, the Shakespeare of the Queen Mab speech with its atomies in Romeo and Juliet, or the Botticelli of the Primavera, which is based on lines from De Rerum Natura, these were the masters not of tolerance, but of the idea-saving, the life-saving art of the cultural xenograft. And the organs that they so deftly harvested and preserved and transplanted continue to live inside us today. Thank you very much.
Stephen, could I bring your two things together here, the Lucretius and Shakespeare? Is there any evidence that Shakespeare knew of anything that Lucretius had written?
I doubt that Shakespeare knew Lucretius directly. It's possible, but it's... as I say, I showed you Ben Jonson. Shakespeare was friends with Ben Jonson. That was Ben Jonson's copy of Lucretius, though Shakespeare is not likely to have seen that particular copy, just by the way, stained with ink. Jonson must have been drunk when he was reading it. It's covered with ink and probably acid, because they used to make ink with acid and so forth. But it's possible the work had been translated. I mean, the work had been not translated. The work had been printed now multiple times, including a little tiny pocketbook like Jonson had. But I doubt it. Not because Shakespeare had... Jonson said that Shakespeare had small Latin, but Shakespeare's small Latin is probably the equivalent of most good Latinists now. But more because there aren't traces of it in the most vivid trace of the presence of Epicureanism in Shakespeare is that word Adams in Romeo and Juliet, and Lucretius doesn't use the word Adams. But where Shakespeare could have... Shakespeare was almost certainly aware of the challenge, broadly speaking. Now, where would he have got it? He would have got it partly because people were talking about this in that Lucy Hutchinson remark, talking quietly about it, partly because Giordano Bruno was in England in the 1580s. He wasn't very happy there, didn't like the food, he thought the weather was lousy, didn't enjoy his stay, and thought the people at Oxford were snobby and didn't like what he had to say. But he was in England for several years and was very good friends with John Florio and with people in the Earl of Southampton circle. So that we know that Shakespeare was part of that world. And it would be extremely, I mean, there's no smoking gun, but it would be extremely unlikely that Shakespeare would not have been touched by that set of ideas which were in circulation, and probably where he picks up that funny term Adams. But it's less a philological connection than an odd thing that begins to appear in... And Romeo and Juliet's an interesting case of this. Romeo and Juliet's a play in which Shakespeare does something that's characteristic of odd thing he does repeatedly. Shakespeare doesn't make up the story of Romeo and Juliet. He rips it off from other people the way he rips off most of his stories. But in all of the sources of Romeo and Juliet, Romeo and Juliet speak of their death as, of course, a sad event, but anticipate an afterlife together. And people speak of them afterwards, about the afterlife that they will have together. And Shakespeare takes that out of his sources, and you can actually watch him do it. There you can watch what he does. And systematically throws that away. And what he does instead is to force whatever is for Romeo and Juliet here and now in this life, and then to force your attention to the grave where they will both rot without any prospect of their souls reunited in the posthumous bliss. And that's part of a pattern in Shakespeare of eliminating the... Shakespeare was not was not a programmatically it was neither programmatically religious nor programmatically secular as an artist. He's a very ambiguous artist. But about that, about the prospects of an afterlife, Shakespeare is fantastically ambiguous and evasive. And at crucial moments, is uninterested. And that, to me, is part of something going on in the late 16th century that probably is about the revival of this set of ideas, which then become much more visible in people like Milton and so forth. Yeah.
Do you believe that culture should have a responsibility in progressing the amalgamation of our knowledge? And if so, should it be institutionalized?
The question would lead to a long conversation. Partly a long conversation would have to do with whether the question really has to do with whether your question is really about high culture or about the phenomenon of culture as a whole, because the phenomenon of culture as a whole is much larger than any institution, obviously. The culture, broadly speaking, is the organization of everything that's not strictly, narrowly instrumental, I assume. And therefore, it has to do with much more than any institution, including educational institutions. But I'm deeply committed personally and professionally and in my heart of hearts to the idea that the inheritance of the long-term inheritance of the cultural creations of the past, which is maybe where the question was going, that is to say, of the stuff the dead people have left us for centuries, that inheritance does actually require institutions to sustain, maintain, support, transmit that. I mean, that it won't survive, at least very easily, on its own. In that sense, I think, I mean, you asked someone who's paid to do this, so I think it's a good thing, a deeply good thing for our world, for society. I think that a purely instrumental world, a world in which things that don't pay off in any immediate sense don't get support from taxpayers or parents shelling out large sums of money for tuition for their kids, or kids running into tremendous debt to get this education. I think that such a culture is much worse off, is in danger. So I am utterly in favor, though I see that it's at a cost, and particularly in economic hard times, one feels the sheer force of the cost. I'm deeply in favor of the task of transmitting culture, including institutionally.
I completely agree. Thank you.
I'm drawn back to your parable of the wheat and the tares. It sounds to me like the Lucretius poem would be the tares in the eyes of the people that you're telling us about. And yet the parable says that the tares are put into bundles and thrown into the fire. That doesn't seem to have happened here, and I wonder if you could explain why not.
Yes. Well, there are several things to say. First of all, I mean, there were people who believed, had a different interpretation of the parable from St. Augustine. They didn't speak out necessarily very energetically because it was risky to do so, but they believed that the moment at which the tares would be thrown into the fire had not come yet, that it was that what Jesus was referring to was the end of time, not this moment, but at some indeterminate period in the future. And there were people in the 15th century, as there are people now, who are passionate, deeply committed Christian believers who disagreed strongly with Augustine's certainty that what Jesus was referring to was the period before his incarnation, not before his return at the end of time. So those people would not have wanted, let's say, there is a hidden streak in Christianity, though, as I say, it really is genuinely hidden, doesn't show its face very often, that in this period, in the 13th, 14th, 15th century, that would find reason to tolerate these beliefs on the grounds that the moment hadn't come yet. to get rid of them. So that even, plus there are the mechanisms that I talked about. People who don't throw it out because they don't even see it. They don't realize they're seeing the tears. Or people who don't throw it out because they're so, the German word would be begeistert, so completely taken by the poetry, so seized by it that they're not looking very clearly at what it's saying. People who are artists thinking that they can take out one piece of this without being contaminated by the whole set of things that it carries with them. So there's lots of different strategies. But there is that as I say, I didn't mean to suggest, and I shouldn't leave it that way, that there was not a kind of undercurrent of, beneath this period of ferocious persecution of heresy, largely within the Christian community, there wasn't an undercurrent of tolerance that fed into at least the possibility of tolerance. As I say, after all, also people had to live together. They killed each other in large numbers, but not constantly. Otherwise, the population would have disappeared. So that they got along for long periods of time, and then they killed each other for a while, and then they got along for long periods of time, and then they killed each other. And for the periods in which they got along, they somehow were able to deal with what otherwise would have been impossible. And it's like the Sunni and the Shia, and it's like, I mean, lots of groups that have such a history of just staggering violence that is interspersed with periods of just getting along for long periods of time. And that is probably crucial to the survival of this text as well. Yeah. Going on. Sorry. Go ahead.
Okay. This is maybe. So at one point you said you were talking about how Lucretius has this idea, okay, so like wisdom begins in wonder. That's like a big phrase, right? And so I've always thought of that in like truth, beauty, and goodness lie at the feet of wonder. And Lucretius comes from the opposite way. And like if truth, beauty, and goodness lie at the feet of wonder, and beauty is one of those, and poetry lies at the feet of beauty, what is that? Okay, so what does it mean that I don't think I understood when you said Lucretius believes in like the reverse of that?
No, what I mean by the reverse, I went too quickly and I didn't put it well. There's a Greek philosophical tradition repeats, Aristotle says it, other people say it, that philosophy begins in wonder. And you wonder about something and then you resolve the wonder, and the wonder, you in effect, you get rid of the experience of wonder. Wonder is the beginning of philosophy. It's not the end of philosophy. The end of philosophy is understanding. But Lucretius, at least I was arguing, uses the poetry and the metaphors in the poetry, which are often, the metaphors are sit in a very peculiar relation to what he is arguing. As I say, this is a work that argues against prayer, but has the most famous prayer in ancient poetry. So why is that? Because I think that the poetry is meant to keep alive the feeling of wondering in the face of what is, after all, what in the case of Lucretius, a dogmatic belief. Lucretius is a dogmatist. The dogma is that there's atoms and emptiness and nothing else. No mystery there. And Lucretius didn't think that it was all up for grabs. He thought that Epicurus, his master, had come up with a solution. The trick is, how do you come up with that solution and not feel unbelievably depressed? And the answer, the poetry, or at least I'm arguing, that the poetry is part of the re-enchantment, as it were, of what appears to be a disenchanted universe. And the argument would be that I saw, by the way, in the very interesting account of what the Hall Center is doing, that is, has Alan de Botton been here already? Mm-hmm. So it's a little bit like the argument that I saw described in that Alan de Botton talk. The experience that religion gives you shouldn't only be for religion, for the priests to have, to make you feel that there's something wonderful about your existence in the universe. It should be possible to hold on to that in a world that has given up on the idea that there are mysterious demons and angels and someone pulling the strings. And Lucretius's poetry is part of a project to keep that feeling going. Lucretius believed that the universe, properly understood, was not like a clock. It was like making love. He thought it was erotic. And he has a very complicated attitude toward erotic life. That's a whole other subject. But he thought that if you didn't get that, if you thought it was just a mechanism, a clockwork mechanism, you were not understanding anything about your life. You weren't understanding the way in which your body is put together out of untold millions, billions of dancing particles that are in some erotic relation to each other. And the poetry is meant to get that and to not to deliver you onto a sterile, empty shore.
Thank you.
I hear a parable in your presentation. You've contrasted, let me read the way I've written it. The orthodoxy of the dominant Western religion during the period you're talking about and to this present day, and the content of Lucretius's poem. I hear a parable for the 21st century. Are you willing to relate your thoughts about what is relevant to the present social and political and religious life that we live?
Thank you for the question. I've always been evasive as a person. I've always wanted to hide behind old dead guys rather than come clean. And that's partly because I don't have such a clear agenda. But I do have thoughts, as it were, so I'll share a few incoherent thoughts with you. I've already shared one, which may be where your perception comes from, which is they say that it's funny that American politicians can't embrace propositions, most of which lie at the basis of most contemporary science. So we have the technology, we accept the technology that the science has come up with, but we detach the technology from the fundamental assumptions about the physical and biological universe that have generated those assumptions. So it's a very complicated subject, but it's largely true. So I'm interested in that phenomenon. And I'm interested in the fact that there are places especially in the United States, which happens to be more religious than most other countries, in which what seems to have emerged already in the earlier 19th century, but certainly by the late 19th century, about the nature of the human experience on Earth, where we come from, is unacceptable. So most people, not most, but large numbers of people, of our fellow citizens, don't believe it. Refuse to believe it. So I'm fascinated by why, what it means that they don't. And I'm fascinated with it not as a way of scolding or because I think people are stupid or wicked, but because it clearly does not correspond to the spiritual longings of many, many, many people in our culture. And it seems to me that Lucretius actually understood already 2,000 years ago that there was this problem in the philosophy that he himself was signing on to, the philosophy of Epicurus from several centuries before him in another culture, and was grappling with this problem that he tried to find a way of conveying to... Lucretius actually was, how should we say, even more implausible to his contemporary Romans than, let's say, Charles Darwin would be to the people of Kansas. That is to say, Lucretius was really making a very weird argument. Rome, when Lucretius is writing at the time of Julius Caesar, at a moment of intense Roman militarism, expansionism, a celebration of violence, of wounds, cults of piety, pagan piety, and so forth. He's arguing completely against this for withdrawing into a kind of philosophical garden, thinking about atoms and emptiness and nothing else, and the pursuit of pleasure. I mean, it was a wildly countercultural argument. And he's trying to figure out how it would be possible to get his contemporaries, whom he believes are on a terrible course of dangerous course, hostile to their environment, needlessly killing the world around them, animals and plants and humans, in a mad desire to accumulate more and more power and wealth, how to get them to step back and figure out who they are and how to come to terms with what he thought was the truth of the truth revealed about the physical and natural world, which was that it's just atoms and emptiness without any big God planning all of this. And in that sense, I do think that he's, I don't know if it's a parable exactly, but I think he's useful. Useful as a way into a project that isn't over and that we're all still trying to figure out how to deal with. I have to confess to you, this is a more terrible confession, I'm a rather religious person. I actually observe religious holidays. I bless my little boy on Friday night. If you ask me, why do I do that? Because I actually don't think, I think it's all flapdoodle. I don't think anyone is telling me to do it or the universe has been put together that way. But I don't want to live in a universe that's completely evacuated from the beneficence of those rituals. And Lucretius got it. He got that the poetry is all about holding on to that and at the same time figuring out how to accept the scientific world.
That's why it's relevant to talk about Lucretius today. The issues haven't changed.
Yes, I'm afraid so.
just one last question, please.
I want to ask you this. I read your book when it first came out, and I was intrigued by the figure of Florio, just how much Shakespeare may have encountered him. But getting to Shakespeare, who is my central interest, it seems to me that Shakespeare grasped and thought about so much more than he spoke of. And I fix on Hamlet's last words, "The rest is silence." And I don't know if he'll agree, but I noticed that rest is a musical term.
Yes.
And so the very end of this horrible moment, there's a pun.
Yes.
Would you agree?
It's a beautiful idea. I mean, I would want, I mean, if I'd like it to be true, and it well may be true. It hadn't occurred to me before. What I'd like to do, I don't know enough about here that the sort of pedant in me is rising. I want to see what when the term rest became, was
I checked OED.
Is it in Morley? Is it in 16th century Italian?
Yes. It's so, in the OED.
As a term, yes. In 16.1 was possible. By all means, then, I love it. It's a wonderful idea.